Okay, this morning, let's go to the book of Leviticus, chapter 17. Let's read verse 11. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I've given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. So it is a blood that maketh atonement for the soul. Verse 14 says, for it is the life of all flesh. The blood of it is the life thereof. Therefore I said unto the children of Israel, you shall not eat the blood of no manner of flesh, for the life of all flesh is in the blood thereof. Whosoever eateth it shall be cut off. Billy Graham was preaching at one particular place, and he had his people around, the camera crew and, you know, the rest of the people over there. The first day he preached, he gave an altar call. There was not a very good response. And that's not likely how his meeting goes. The second day he preached, he gave an altar call. Just a few people turned up. And so he was wondering what's happening. And I think it was George Werwer that spoke to him and said, as they call him Billy, he said to me, he says, Billy, you spoke yesterday and today, but I never heard you talk on the blood. And he said, yes. Almost every message of mine, I must bring the blood out. I'm going to do it tomorrow, which is the last day of the meeting. So he spoke on the blood. The full message was the blood. He gave an altar call. There was no room at the altar. People were thronging at the altar. That's the power that is in the blood. The blood draws people to the Lord Jesus Christ. It was a priest that I heard that made a statement in his church. And this is what he said. He said, do you know what makes the blood of Jesus Christ powerful and strong, that miracles can take place? He says, because he's born of Mary, and it's Mary's blood that makes his blood powerful. When I heard that statement, I thought to myself, this man does not understand medical science in the first place. And so it's not the blood of Mary. It's not the blood of any saints. It's not the blood of any gurus. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that has power. And only his blood. Yesterday, I was spending some time and, you know, studying on the blood and getting some new insights on the blood, new revelation on the blood. And I was getting so excited. And I was thanking God. I said, Lord, I thank you that your blood is so powerful. I thank you, Lord, there's so much of victory in your blood. And I was worshiping God for what I see found in his blood, not knowing that as I was doing that, I was coming under the covering of his blood. So I was doing that. And then around 5 o'clock, I had Arvind and Chitra come to my office. They came for counseling. And so I counseled the couple, and they left. And immediately, I proceeded to the hospital to pray for the boy who was suffering from dengue. So I walk in over there, I'm standing, minding my own business, and the nurse, you know, fixing all the tube and all, and she kept on looking at me, making eye contact. So I was under the impression, you know, all you guys wait until I finish, you know, because that's what happens in the ward. They don't want, you know, visitors when they're doing the medical attention over there. And so she was fixing that, and she kept on looking at me. 2-3 times she looked at me, and, like, you know, she was trying to turn her back against me. Very weird she was acting. So anyway, she finished. She comes, she passes me, and as soon as she crossed me and came the other side, she dropped. But she not only dropped, she was manifesting. It was surely an evil. She pulled, you know, the attendant's bed. She pulled the bed sheet off, and she was acting crazy. She was pounding on the ground. And within 2 or 3 minutes, the ward was packed with all nurses. And so they were trying to carry her and take her to the doctor. I said, don't take her to the doctor. Let me pray. Some of them agreed. Some of them never agreed. So I said, let me pray, because the Lord's name has to be glorified. And I prayed. The moment I started praying, she got delivered. She came back to herself, and so I told him, you don't have to take her to the doctor. Now, that happened over there. The next bed was an African guy. He was a Muslim. I never knew he was a Muslim. So I walked up to him. I said, can I pray for you? He looked at me fearfully. He must have been thinking, you know, that lady fell down, something happened, or what is he coming to me? And so I asked him, I said, are you a Christian? He said, no, I'm a Muslim. So I said, can I pray? He said, yes. So I proclaimed Jesus as Lord. And I prayed for him. But what I'm trying to communicate, that's the power in the blood. Amen? I mean, when you're covered with the blood, my brother, my sister, demons will flee. Amen. So, let me draw some parallels over here. Now, you know, when we look at the natural blood that we have and the entire system or the way it has been structured in our body, as I made a study, I found out it has a parallel spiritually. So natural and spiritually go in parallel. So let's look at it in the natural. In the human body, there are different kinds of tissues. And some of those tissues could be defined as connecting tissues, or fat, or gland, or muscles, bone. They're all tissues. Now, what I'm saying is not just what I'm saying. I mean, I looked at it from the medical point of view. So I'm quoting, you know, medical science as well to prove to you certain facts about the natural blood. And there's a parallel in the spiritual blood. Now, all these tissues have one thing in common. They are fixed. They don't move. They are fixed cells. Unlike the blood. And I was, for the first time I read that even blood is like a tissue. But the blood moves into different parts of the body, and while it travels different parts of the body, it carries nourishment to supply the fixed tissues or the fixed cell. At the same time, as it even carries nourishment, it also begins to clean. It takes out all the waste matter from the body and will flush it out. I want you to know this morning that the blood of Jesus Christ travels to every member of his body. Each one of us are a member of his body. And his blood begins to move and travels. And as it begins to travel and bring in nourishment, my brother, my sister, we are being nourished by the blood. If that's how it happens in the natural, that's exactly how it happens in the spiritual. And not only does it bring nourishment, but it also removes all the garbage, all the waste product, and it'll begin to flush it out. That's what the blood does. The blood actually brings unification, or it unifies and also purifies. It's only the blood that purifies and has the power to purify and to begin to connect us to the head. That's the operation of the blood. In the book of Acts in chapter 17 and verse 26 is a statement that's made. Let's read it. God made one blood of all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth. Only one blood. And that one blood starts from Adam. He's made one common blood. So we all have a common origin in Adam. And since we are in Adam, his blood runs into us. Amen. And because his blood runs into us, my brother, my sister, we are all dead. Can you say amen? The moment Adam ate the fruit, he died. And there's a death sentence pronounced upon you and me, because his blood runs through us. The moment he partook of the fruit, it was blood poisoning. And all our blood is we are dead because Adam's blood passes through us. But listen, in the book of Genesis in chapter 2 and verse 7, God made Adam, formed him from the dirt of the ground. Now, when Adam was formed, he was just limpless, lifeless flesh on the ground. But God did something. Looking at that verse over there, God breathed into his nostrils. What did he do? The breath of life. He breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and as a result of that, he became a living soul. So I want you to imagine this. Adam's on the ground. He's lifeless, has absolutely no life. God comes now and breathes into his nostrils, and suddenly he stands. Life came into his body. The breath of God brought life into his body. So when I read that verse of scripture, I wanted to find out exactly, because we got to have verses to support the verse that we just read. Amen? So I wanted to find out, what life was that? Yes, we all know it was the Ruach of God, the Spirit of God. But the scripture has to prove as to what life did he receive. So in order to get the proof of that, we go back to chapter 17 of the book of Leviticus. And let's read one verse of scripture over here, or maybe two verses. We're going to verse 11. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. Go to verse 14. Verse 14 says, for it is the life of all flesh. The blood of it is the life thereof. And the last part of that verse, it says, for the life of the flesh is the blood thereof. So let's draw a conclusion over here. When God breathed into that lifeless flesh, it had no life. Suddenly that flesh became living. Now this verse says the life of the flesh is in the blood. So now we come to an understanding. It was not just the breath of God in the nostrils of Adam that gave him life, but apart from the breath of God, it was an impartation of blood. You agree with that? Amen? It was an impartation of blood. So when blood came into Adam, he became a living soul. When Adam sinned, his blood became sinful. His blood was corrupted. Now, his flesh was not sinful. It's only his blood that became sinful. But however, because his blood reaches his flesh also became sinful. It was not sinful in his flesh originally. It was his blood. But later, his flesh also became sinful. Now, as I read that, and as I was going into the study, I was so amazed to look at the infinite wisdom of God Almighty. God Almighty knew that Adam was going to sin, and Adam's blood was going to be contaminated. God knew it. And so God, who knew that, he planned something that was far greater than human imagination as to how he will bring salvation to humanity, again by using blood. What did God do? We're looking at something amazing over here. The virgin birth of Jesus Christ. Since sin came into human being, the blood was affected. But not so with the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. So what happened was, Adam was not his father. Joseph either was not his father. Because if either one of them had to be the father of Jesus, his blood again will be contaminated. His blood will be sinful. So what happened was, God had to once again impart his blood into the womb of Mary. The very same way his blood came into Adam before sin came into Adam. It has to be the same blood. Amen. Adam was sinless until sin came. Adam was sinless because the blood of God came into Adam, gave him life. That same blood that came into Adam before sin entered into Adam was the same blood that comes into the womb of Mary, and now Jesus Christ is conceived by that blood, the blood that came into the last Adam from the Father of God Almighty. Now, how do I prove this? How can I prove this scientifically? Because it was not the blood of Adam or any human blood. So therefore, when Jesus Christ was conceived in the womb of Mary, and thereafter when he was born, his blood was sinless. But my brother, my sister, at the same time, he was a partaker of Adam's flesh, not of his blood. But though he was a partaker of Adam's flesh, and Adam's flesh was sinful, yet the blood, the flesh of Jesus Christ was not sinful, because the blood of Jesus Christ did not have sin, and because his blood did not have sin, therefore his flesh cannot have sin. Are you understanding the point over here? And that's the reason why there was only one man and only one man in the entire universe that could qualify to bring you redemption. No matter how good a man could be, no matter how righteous a man could be, no matter, you know, how is he canonized as being 10 times a saint, he still does not qualify to redeem you, because his blood is sinful, his flesh is sinful. It's only the blood of Jesus Christ that is sinless, and his flesh is sinless. From conception. And I have a few doctors over here. You could correct me if I'm wrong. It doesn't matter. You can stand up and correct me, and I'll take the correction. And the reason why I can make these statements, because I'm looking at it from the scientific point of view after me studying it. Okay? So I'm open to correction. From conception till birth of a child, not a single drop of blood passes from the mother to the child. Am I right, doctors? But, however, you have soluble nutrients or elements such as proteins or fat, carbohydrates, salt, minerals, and even antibodies that could pass from the mother to the child, not blood. Amen? And the waste product of the child comes back into the mother's circulation, which is called the child's metabolism. Not a drop of blood. Well, listen, my brothers and sisters. If that is so, can you see the plan of God when he was creating blood in the human race? Because he knew that he will have to have his son, who is the last Adam, that will have to be conceived in the womb of a woman and to be born naturally, supernatural conception, but naturally be born. And when he's born, he will not have the blood of Mary, nor the blood of Joseph, or even from Adam. But it has to be the blood of God, because not a single drop of blood passes from the mother to the child. Amen? Praise God. Isn't God awesome? God is wonderful. Amen. Now we have white cells. The white cells have a defense system in our body. And basically, they do two things. Number one, it provides blood clotting. In the case of any damage on your body, or even if a nerve is severed, immediately the white cells provide blood clotting. You know why? It provides that blood clotting to avoid further damage. The blood of Jesus Christ provides blood clotting in every member over here in the case of some mishap, so that further danger is not caused. My brother, my sister, there's always a parallel to the natural and the supernatural. Amen. God takes care. He has a defense system built up on the inside of you and me. And the enemy goes bonkers. I mean, he looks, he says, I'm trying everything possible, but I cannot succeed in my assignment against the children of God. He tries to bring some damage, but immediately the blood of Jesus Christ brings a cloth in over us to prevent further damage. Secondly, what the white cells also do is not only does it provide blood clotting, but it provides antibodies to avoid any infection entering into us. There's an inbuilt system in our body that prevents antibodies, that produces antibodies that prevent any kind of infection from the world coming into our bodies. Hallelujah. There's a wonderful mechanism that takes place in our bodies. The blood acts as a vehicle that carries all the waste products and the garbage in our body. That's what the blood does. And it begins to clean everything. It carries all the garbage and it takes it out and it begins to dispose it through secretion. Through the kidney, skin, and bowels. And at the same time, as it begins to clean the entire system, carrying all the garbage away, it's the same vehicle that provides food to our body. Well, let me put it across like this. Imagine you have the garbage van coming into your house, carries all the garbage from your house, and the same garbage van supplies you food. Would you take it? I don't think so. Not even if there's a famine. You won't touch it. Because it causes contamination. In the first place, it's not hygienic. But do you know, the blood of Jesus Christ removes all the garbage and supplies food and yet does not cause contamination. Amen? I mean, it's beyond our comprehension to see how it happens in the natural and how it happens in the spiritual as well. Amen? God is so wonderful, you know, as he provides this wonderful system of the blood that circulates within the body. Now, in Passover, or the Feast of Passover that we celebrate, something happens. The Hebrew meaning of Passover has two meanings. Because let's have in mind, in the first place, when Passover came, it's a Hebrew concept. So if it's a Hebrew concept, we need to understand the Hebrew explanation of what Passover is. Now, we all celebrate Passover, and you know we celebrate Passover even at the communion that we have. Amen? And on Good Friday, many people think of Passover. But let me tell you the two things or the two meaning of the word Passover, and after which I want to pray for you. Meaning number one, the Lord said, he said, when I see the blood sprinkled on the doorposts and the lintels of your house, when I see the blood as a token, I will pass over. So he says, I will pass over. Now, the death angel that comes along, my brother, my sister, is a kind of a judgment that the Lord is sending to begin to bring destruction upon them who continue to be rebellious against God. God was allowing this death angel to come. But the death angel was given an order. Wherever you see the blood, don't enter him. Passover. So the death angel came and passed over. But wherever the blood was not, the death angel never passed over, but passed in. And when the death angel passed in, my brother, my sister, every firstborn was dead, died. Now I want you to know, in one house, In one household, the father could be the firstborn, the grandfather could be the firstborn, the grandchildren could be a firstborn, so they were equal, they were equivalent to about 7 to 8 people died in one house. Amen? I'm the firstborn in my house. My son is the firstborn in my family. And, you know, if my father was firstborn in his family, if we all lived together, we all died. Every firstborn. So the death angel came in, brought destruction, and as a result, there was sorrow. There was lamentation. There was weeping. There was distress over there because of what happened. The death angel never passed over, but the death angel passed in. But at the same time, the second meaning of the word Passover, the Lord says, when I see the blood, I will pass over, not allow destruction to come in, but at the same time, I will pass in. He says, but when I pass in, I'm not going to bring destruction, I'm going to bring healing. Because let's have in mind that at the first Passover that was celebrated in Egypt, according to the book of Psalm, it says, not one of them were feeble, every one of them were healed. That's what happens when the Lord sees the blood. That every drop of blood from the body of Jesus Christ was shed. And Jesus Christ died when his blood left his body. There was not a single drop of blood that was left in his body. He died after his blood left. My brother, my sister, where did that blood go? Where did that last drop of blood, from the time he started to shed till the last drop, where did that blood go? It was not wasted. That blood came back into his body. And when that blood came back into his body that was dead, his body came back to life. The blood came back into his body. And where do you think his body is today, seated in this room? His blood has been emptied into our body. This is not blood transfusion. My brother, my sister, this is blood, or could I use the word, instead of using the word transfusion, blood transplant. Being transplanted into our body. And today we have that blood. So in my conclusion to you this morning, my brother, my sister, we have the blood of the Lord. I'm asking you a question today. Are you under the blood? Have you been covered by the blood? Do you have a daily experience of coming under the covering and the protective power of the blood of the Lamb? I think when we rise up, say, Lord, cover me with your blood today. Cover my family with your blood today. Lord, I begin a day. And, you know, let's have in mind that the Hebrew people, they had to kill the lamb, they had to take the blood and apply it, and only after they did that, they came under the blood. Don't they think it's the same for us today? We got to apply the blood. You know, it doesn't come by just sitting and saying, thank you for the blood, Lord. We got to apply it. Our word is a word of faith. Lord, I apply your blood.